following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
Runes, love, ear, and man. These runes are intimately related. We cannot speak one without taking into account the other two. This is why we are going to talk in general with this, related with these three runes, which in the alphabet, runic alphabet, have the number 14, Laf, 15, Man, and 16, Ear. As you can see, the rune ear is an upside-down rune man. This is the reason why it is not possible to talk about the rune ear without taking into account the rune man. And of course, the man, the rune man, represents, as his name states, man. And the other rune state symbolizes the woman, which is really the opposite. And between them, we find the rune Laf, which symbolizes the stone, the philosopher's stone of Yesod. It is related with the letter L. When I say El, comes into my mind the Hebrew word El, which means God. And of course, as always, we relate these runes with the Aztec calendar, which is a stone chiseled by initiates in the ancient times, and which is very popular in our present times. If you are observant, you will see that these three runes and all the runes are hidden within the structure of this Aztec calendar. If we watch the next graphic related with these three runes, we see the first, which is Laf, in relation with two human positions. The first one in the left, which is a human being with a straight body, whose arms are forming with the body an angle of 45 degrees. Next to it is another human body in the attitude of motion or walking. And it is because the rune Lav relates to certain motion that we have to learn in this lecture. And that's why we place the second graphic next to the first related with this Lav, to indicate that in order to perform the rune, we have to walk towards the east, the sunrise. And if you see the next rune in the human shape, you see another body whose arms are similar to the position of the rune Lav. The body that we see is, of course, in front, facing, not in the profile like the first rune Lav. And the arms are also forming an angle of 45 degrees. And this is precisely the position of the rune Ear, which also we find in other traditions that they represent this rune by a man standing on his head, which also could be symbolized by this rune Ear. In the tradition of Hinduism, among the yogis, there is a position that is called Sirsasana, in which the man places his whole body on his head and stands. And of course, we are going to talk about this rune as well, but most related in the practical sense with the position that we are seeing there, that is similar to the rune Lav, with the difference that when you perform the rune Ear, you are not walking, you are just standing. Now, the next one, which is the rune Man, even though the rune Ear is after the rune Man, but we put it in this way in order to show you the similarities of the Lav with the Ear. But in reality, the rune Man comes after Lav. The rune Man is, as you see, a man lifting his arms aloft in order to pray. And we will see how these two runes relate to each other in relation with the lecture, in relation with the practices of esotericism. First, let us begin to see the rune Lav. As you see there, the symbol of the rune is related with the man or the human body in motion. But also, we place this symbol now that you can see in the graphics that we place in the website of the Aztec calendar, which is, as you know, a stone circle, and that many scholars in this day and age are studying it. Of course, the rune Lav relates with the stone, the Aztec calendar. Not only because you can see how the Aztec calendar relates to the circle of 360 degrees. Many people ask, why does the circle has 360 degrees? Why not 400? Well, here we find the answer. The circle relates to the year that has 360 days. And although in these times we know that the year has 365, but if you inquire and study the solar year in many religions and traditions, you will find always that it is related to 360. And of course it is, because the number 9 is that number that is hidden within the circle, because the circle indeed symbolizes the ninth sphere, which is Yesod. And that's why we associate the rune Laf with the Aztec stone, the Aztec calendar. That is easy to see. That if you make the addition of any of the angles of this philosophical stone, Aztec calendar, you will see that the 9 is always protruding in any size. 360, make the addition of 9. And if you want to make the half of the circle, it's 180, which makes the addition of 9. And of course, the straight angle, this is how you call it, the right angle, is 90, which is 9. And below the circle that we are showing here, which is the third part or the three parts of the circle, is 270, which makes the addition of 9. If you take the time to add every number in between the 40, the 90 angles that you find here, you will see that every small number between 360, for instance, and 90, you find a number that add the addition of 9. And every angle, the addition of 9 and 9. So 9, of course, is the mystery of life. Remember that the rune Laf means life, related with a sexual force, and how the sexual energy of the Holy Spirit, related with the solar force, relates to this marvelous Aztec calendar. Indeed, the Aztec calendar encloses a lot of mysteries. We place on top of it, as you can see, the cross, which is black. And on top of it, another cross, which is orange or yellow, if you want, related with the arrows that you find around the circle of the Aztec calendar. In order to show you how the Aztec calendar is indicating the four cardinal points: north, south, east, west, northeast, northwest, southwest, southeast. And this is something very clear that the initiates that chiseled this marvelous stone were indicating how the nine sphere, which is called in Kabbalah Yesod, relates to everything in order to perform what we need to perform. For instance, if you count the squares that are forming the body of each serpent, you find that they have 11 squares. 11 is a very significant number that indicates, of course, two ones, the man and the woman. And this man and the woman, or the two polarities, the two forces, are represented in the two serpents. The one that is Quetzalcoatl in the right, and the one that is Tezcatlipoca in the left, which are indicating the east and the west. As in Kabbalah, we say Tifereth is the east, and Malkut is the west. So this indicates, of course, that 11 plus 11 squares are forming the 22 arcana of the tarot, which is deeply significant. So in every way that you see this, you see how these runes relate to this marvelous stone that we always talk about. For instance, the rune Laf, if you can see the angle here in the very bottom of the stone, you have the angle of 45 degrees that is formed by the south with the southeast, which is precisely indicating that in order to know the mystery of the philosopher's stone, you have to go down. Down also in your physicality, because that philosophical stone is a symbol of the sexual energy, of the genitalia. And of course, above, you find the three lines of the rune Mand, forming by the arrow that points upwards and the two yellow arrows that are pointing northeast, northwest. And the opposite, which is the rune Ear, is symbolized in the arrow that is pointing to the south, the black arrow, with the other yellow arrows, southeast and southwest. So as we have stated in other lectures, all the runes are hidden within the philosopher's stone within the Aztec calendar, which is really the philosopher's stone. Because the two serpents that you see here in each side of the calendar or around the calendar represents the two primary forces, Ida Pingala, that are entwined in the spine and that are protruding or rooted in the testicles and in the ovaries. So these two polarities, of course, are showing us that the whole work that we had to perform with the stone, with the nine sphere, is represented in the Aztec calendar in a very beautiful way. For instance, if you investigate how they are placing the 5 days that are missing there of 360, which is the degrees of the circle, then you find, of course, that the Aztec calendar relates to the days. The children of the first son, the second son, the third son, the fourth son, and we say that we are the children of the fifth son. So therefore, the days that we are missing in the circle are represented in the very center of the Aztec calendar, with the four squares related to the former four root races, or former cosmic days, of this planet Earth. And we are in the fifth, which is the center. So there you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 days, cosmic days, related to the solar Aztec calendar, in order to indicate that they didn't ignore that the actual day has 365 days. Everything is indicated in a very alchemical, Kabbalistical manner for the esotericist. And of course, to apply all of this knowledge here is precisely the point in Gnosticism. If you observe also the Aztec stone, you will see that every serpent has on its back six flames with four wicks, each flame. The number four reminds us the Tetragrammaton, the powerful name of God, Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh, with which every esotericist has to work in the nine sphere. And of course, the six flames of each serpent are indicating as Tifereth, which is the human soul. In other words, the one that has to descend into the ninth sphere in order to work with the fires of the sun, S-U-N, is the soul, Tifereth. And that's why it is indicated in the Tree of Life, when you see the Tree of Life, that the sun is really related with Tifereth. And this is indicated here in the Aztec calendar with the center, which is Tonatiuh, the sun, which is squeezing hearts with its pass or class, if you want. That heart, of course, relate to Tifereth, which is always the center of the Tree of Life and also the center of the Aztec calendar. But two hearts, because the mystery of the stone relates to the man and woman. And this is precisely indicated in the two runes, man and ear. Now, the rune man, of course, that comes after the rune laugh, indicates that the human soul, whether from the woman or from the man, is the one that has to work in the ninth sphere. And that's why when we make the addition of the human soul, which is Tifereth, the sixth Sephira, plus the ninth sphere, which is Laf, we make the addition, we make 15. So 9 and 6 is 15, which is precisely the rune man, which relates to many words in the English and German language. Man reminds us manas, the mind in Sanskrit, and also manus, which is in Latin hand. And that's why in all the positions of the runes, the hand has a special relation with all the energies that we have to handle. And in any scripture, the hand always points at the willpower, at the action that we had to perform when we were to do something. The book of Revelation states, for instance, that the sign of the beast is in the hands and in the head. So the head is the mind. And the hands related to manus as well, the rune man. It comes into my mind the symbol of Jesus Christ that I spent and always doing this sign. The thumb, the index, and the middle finger pointing the rune man. So it is very significant that the rune man is related with manus, with the hand of Christ. Indicating, of course, that everything that we do, action that we perform, relates, of course, to the mind. Remember also that the seal of God is received in the forehead. So if we continue talking about this philosopher's stone and the number 9 in relation also with 6, you will understand why the hour has 60 minutes and why the minute has 60 seconds. Those measurements come from the past. And it is because the soul, the human soul, is the one that has to be here and now. Second after second in 1 minute. Minute after minute in 1 hour. Of the 24 hours. And the number 24 goes directly to the stone as well. Because the number 24 relates to nature. To the mother nature. Is the weaver. That is woven in the loom of God. It's our divine mother. So you find there the 24 hours of the day related to the activity of the sun. 12 hours of light, 12 hours of night that we already talked about in other lectures. That's why when you see, for instance, the east in the Aztec calendar or in the circle of 360, you find that the east is symbolized by zero. Because it's precisely the journey of the sun. When the sun starts to rise in the east, this is how the solar light moves around the circle, which in this case is the earth. We will say that the center is the sun, and that moves around is the earth. The earth, in this case, are we, philosophically speaking, the philosophical earth. And we go around the Christ, which is the solar light, through the rules and codes that we know and that are indicating in the Aztec calendar in order for us to perform the great work. That's why in other lectures I told you that when we talk about the Philosopher's Stone, we also talk about the Holy Grail. And I told you that the Grail is your physicality, your own physical body and symbols, but also symbolizes the stone. So when you talk about the stone, the Philosopher's Stone and the Grail is the same thing, but has different ways in order to interpret, different interpretations that you have to know by intuition. When you know alchemy, when you are a practical initiate. Let us see, for instance, the next graphic in which you find this woman symbolizing the rune Laf, having her two arms forming an angle of 45 degrees with her body. And that's precisely the symbol of the rune Laf, which is life. Why don't the hands reach the level of the sexual organs? The rune is indicating us that really the true life, or the life that we are searching for, the power of the Grail, resides in Yesod, the sexual organs. We find this quotation in the book Parsifal by Wolfram von Eckenbach, which talks about the stone and the grail at the same time. Let us read it. He said, "The grail castle recalls the pagan otherworld, where there is no aging and no disease, and where the immortals feast on whatever they like best. But the grail is now a stone, which resembles the philosopher's stone of the alchemists. It too surpassed all earthly perfection, cured disease, and kept its possessor forever young. I will tell you how they are fed. They live from a stone whose essence is pure. It is called lapis exilis, magnes. By virtue of magic, this stone, the phoenix is burned to ashes, in which she is reborn. Thus does the phoenix mold her feathers, after which she shines dazzling and bright, and as lovely as before. However ill a mortal man may be, from the day on which he sees the stone, he cannot die for that week, nor does he lose his color. For if anyone, maid or man, were to look at the grail for 200 years, you will have to admit that his color was as fresh as in his early prime. Such powers does the stone confer on mortal men, that their flesh and bones are soon made young again. This stone is also called the Grail." If you don't know alchemy, you won't understand why the stone is called the Grail. Because really, another symbol of the Holy Grail is the yoni, the feminine yoni, the sexual organ of the woman. I told you that the Grail symbolizes your physicality, which is Malkut, which is feminine. But in the feminine body, the Grail is the sexual organ. So when a man is looking for the Grail, he's looking for a woman. That's why in this graphic we put a woman performing the rune laugh in order to indicate that the most perfect representation of the Grail is the woman, because she has that cup that we need to drink for. Now, who is the one that finds the Grail among the knights of the Round Table? If you know the legend, you know that Parsifal is the one that finds the Grail. And Wagner wrote that marvelous opera, Parsifal. The master Samael on Veor wrote a book, The Parsifal Unveiled, in which he describes the mysteries of this great opera. Of course, the one that wrote the book was Ehrenberg. But in the opera, Wagner calls Parsifal, Foul Parsi, which in Arabic, they say, means the innocent fool. But of course, if you associate the words, the root of the words, when you pronounce them, you find foul, which relates to phallus. Parsi, some say that is from Persia, the Parsis. But also, if we take the Latin language, we will say per se. The phallus per se is the one, the only one, that can find the Grail. And this is pretty obvious. No one can find the Grail but phall per se, the phallus per se. Because it is a sexual organs, sexual organ that penetrates the sexual feminine Grail. And this is how initiates in the past hide the mystery of the Grail. And in the name of Parsifal, in order for you to understand, and why Wagner changes the name and call him Foul Parsi, the innocent fool. And who is the fool that falls in the Grail? When the man penetrates the woman and fornicates, when he reaches the orgasm, he is the fool. So all of us are the fool, the Foul Parsi. But only through the Grail is how we can reconquer the youth. Because the Grail, the stone, is laugh, run, laugh, the life. You see how everything is hidden, and how the masters in the ancient times left everything in stone in order for you to study it. But the main point is here that people always like to read things literally. They don't use their intuition. When you read something, you have to sit, close your eyes, and meditate. Why is Parsifal the one that finds the Grail? Why Wagner calls him Foul Parsi? And then you study the language, the word, the logos, which is Christ, which is the origin of all languages. And then you see how everything is hidden within the sacred words. And that's why we state the man, the rune man, and the rune ear, which is the opposite, united, are forming the rune Hagal that we talk about Unite both runes, and you will see the rune Hagal again, with which all the runes, all the letters of the runic alphabet are hidden. In other words, all the words, the logos, the Christ, is hidden between the man and the woman. When they perform the sexual act, they are before God. But because humanity ignore about the mystery of the Grail and the mysteries of esotericism, when they perform the sexual act, they become the fool. They fornicate. And so the fool is represented by that man, which is upside down. And that's why the runic ear is also represented by an upside down man. A man that falls into fornication. And that's why any black magician is represented by the upside down cross. Because he is using the sexual act, the cross of masculine with feminine, and fornicates and falls. But we cannot state that the rune ear is negative 100%. We will say it's dual. It depends how you utilize sex. Because remember that it is necessary to descend into the ninth sphere in order to enter into initiation. And the one that indicates this dissension is the rune Laf and Peter. Peter, the apostle of Jesus, remember, was crucified upside down. Does that mean that Peter is a black magician? No. He's indicating that if you want to rise, you have to go down. But not to fornicate, but to transmute the sexual force. It's not to renounce sex, how you are going to go up, is what many people in this day and age misunderstand. Knowing that the grail and the mystery of sex, the sexual force, is a mystery of self-realization, they want to renounce sex. And they become monks and nuns. It is good for somebody that is single, that is not married, to be a nun or to be a monk before getting married, in order to prepare themselves to matrimony. But to think that you are going to self-realize yourself only by being a monk or a nun is 100% a mistake. Nobody can do it. Because the mystery of the rune Laf indicates that when you unite the arms of two Lafs, then you form the letter M of matrimony. As you see in the graphic, we see they said two joined Lafs is matrimony. And you can see that the shape, in the shade of the man and the woman, holding hands, forming the M. And those hands are at the level always of the genitalia. Because this is how the man and the woman unite through the sexual act. They pronounce their vows, etc., and live together. But the real moment in which those two physicalities, psyches, spirits, joined in one body is in the sexual act. And that's why the sexual act, matrimony, is sacred. It's a sacrament. But everybody perform the ceremony in any religion that they belong to. And when they go to the sexual act, they act like the fool. They fornicate. Only the initiates that know the mystery of the rune Laf know that when they go into the matrimony, they have to perform the sexual act without reaching the spasm or the orgasm of animals in order to steal the fire from the devil and to give life to themselves. Most of the people feed the devil. What devil? Well, the ego that we have within, the lust, the animality that we have within, that's the devil. It's not outside, it's within. And God is within also. That's why the letter Mem or M is pretty significant, and it's always related to the Holy Spirit. As you know, in other lectures that we gave in relation with the Hebrew alphabet, we know that the letter Mem relate to sexuality, relate to the Holy Spirit, relate to matrimony, to the two loves. Let me go here now to the other graphic. The rune ear. As you see, the rune ear, the shape of it in the human body, you see very clearly the similarity with the rune laugh. But here, well, of course, we are showing the two arms separated from the body 45 degrees as well, in order to show the two arms that go down at the rune ear, and the two legs are forming the straight line of the rune ear, to indicate that the dissension that the root ear is indicating in its shape is related with the work in the ninth sphere as well. And there's precisely the similitude. And of course, among the symbols of the rune ear, you find the symbol of Peter. Peter, in the first letter, chapter 2, verses 6 to 8, states, "Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense." When we talk about sex, people scandal. People are offended also when we clarify certain rules in relation with sexuality, because then we uncover the degeneration which every one of us has. But you see there in the graphic in which we are pointing at Peter, when he was going to be crucified, he asked, "Please don't crucify me as my Lord," which is the rune man, by the way. "I want to be crucified upside down, the opposite of my Lord, the rune ear." Because Peter relates to the pineal gland. Many times we told you that. Peter, the apostle, is faith that we have in the pineal gland. And in the pineal gland, we have the atom of the Holy Spirit. The pineal gland is that gland that controls the sexual genitalia, sexual force. In order for you to control the sexual energy, you need to fortify your pineal gland. In order to fortify the pineal gland, you need to transmute your sexual energy. This is how Peter is capable of building the church of the Lord. Because upon this stone, I will build my church. The stone is sex, because only the sexual force can create the inner bodies, the Merkabah, within each one of us. And that's why, as you see there, Peter is lifting his head, like indicating, "Behold, I am going to work with the earth, because the cross is going to be inserted into the earth," which symbolizes the woman. "But look, I am lifting myself from the cross." Like saying, you do the same. When you unite yourself with a woman, lift your sexual force to the head, and know that the head controls or the brain has to control the sex. Because usually, the sex controls the brain. And that's why our brain is degenerated. When you start controlling your sexual force with your brain, then your brain develops. And then you can see things that you cannot see easily when your brain is degenerated. That's why all of this symbol that we talk about, people ask, how do you know that? It's because we put in activity our brain, because we perform this. But people usually, they are Christians, Jewish, Buddhists, whatever, they used to fornicate. So the one that received the punishment for fornication is their brain. And when they read Buddhism, Christianity, or Judaism, Kabbalah, they do not understand, they cannot see, because their brain is damaged. That's the truth. We want to regenerate our brain. Well, then we need to transmute the sexual force, the life that we have in the body. And then the brain will act, start developing. And then that precisely, what is Peter? Because Peter is in the pineal gland. The pineal gland is the power related with the chakra Sahasrara, the crown chakra. That's why Peter is associated with the Elder of Days in Kabbalah. So it is necessary to descend, is what Peter is indicating there. But with the cross, he's indicating that the woman has to be there. Because the horizontal beam represents the woman, and the vertical, the man, united in the sexual act. It means that each one of us has his own particular individual Peter. You have to allow Peter to descend with you into the sexual act and to help you to transmute your sexual force in order to ascend into the higher Sephiroth. That's why the Master Samael on the Or wrote, the descent into the ninth sphere was in ancient mysteries the highest trial to prove the supreme dignity of the Hierophant. Hermes, Buddha, Dante, Zoroaster, etc. had to descend to the ninth sphere in order to work with the fire and water, the origin of worlds, beasts, humans, and gods. Sexual energy is the origin of everything. You want to create a true disciple of the Lord Christ within you, well, you have to imitate Peter. That's why it is crucified upside down. This is the rune ear. And it is because real, indeed, the rune ear represents ourselves. We are the terrestrial man. The terrestrial man, represented by the rune ear, is the opposite of the heavenly man, which is the rune man, which is above. That's why when you talk about the rune man, you have to talk about the trident. Let us go into the rune man and to study the trident, which is really the opposite. As you see also, the rune ear is a trident, but upside down. The three parts of the trident of the rune man represent the true man in us. And that is the divine triad, which in theosophy are called Atman Budi Manas, and which in Kabbalah is called Chesed, Geburah, and Tiferet. That's the monad. That's the true man in us. That's why in Kabbalah, the great patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, are represented in the three Sephiroth, or the triangle of ethics, Chesed, Geburah, and Tiferet, because that's the true man. We are the rune ear, that has to work. But remember that the innermost has two twin souls, the divine and the human. At 100 years old, in esoteric age, the divine soul fuses with the innermost, and so a new master is born with the internal worlds. At 500 years of age, the soul fuses with the innermost. That is how a new Mahatma is born within the internal worlds. This is written by the Master Samael in the Manual of Practical Magic book. If we are stating this, it's because we have to understand, to comprehend the monad, the triad, which is the real man within us in relation with the rune man. When we talk about the being, we talk about the two superior parts of the monad as well, which is Chesed and Geburah. The master explains very clear that in the first initiation of major mysteries, when the Kundalini, the life, the rune life, reaches the pineal gland, then the monad is united. Chesed and Geburah become one. The innermost and the divine soul become one. But they are always in heaven. That's why the rune man represents the man lifting aloft, I mean, the arms pointing to heaven to indicate that the true man is above, nor below. So obviously, there are many degrees of mastery. The first degree of mastery of major mysteries is when the innermost is united with the divine soul in the first initiation. But also there are other initiations of nine mysteries, the lesser mysteries. And everyone that is receiving these initiations internally, which is the monad of the initiate, is a master of first degree, second degree, third degree, fourth degree, fifth degree, until ninth degree of minor initiations. But before that, any one of us has a level of mastery in relation with the law of evolution. Because in order for a monad to enter from the mineral kingdom into the plant kingdom, the monad needs to reach the mastery in the mineral kingdom. In order to enter into the animal kingdom, the monad has to have the mastery of the mineral kingdom and plant kingdom. And when the monad enters into the human kingdom, the mastery of the animal kingdom, plant kingdom, and mineral kingdom already are reached internally. Those levels of mastery, of course, are received by any monad, which is related just with the mechanicity of nature. But when we talk about the minor mysteries, that is only by working with sexuality. And when you are, we will say, recapitulating the level of masteries in internal worlds, and your monad is receiving degrees, initiations. So that's why we always state every single monad is a master inside of us. That's the guru inside of us. Now, among the monads, or the mastery or the hierarchy of those masters, different degrees. One thing is, of course, a master of the lesser mysteries. And another thing is a master that already entered into the path that goes to Nirvana, that has the first initiation of major mysteries. Another is the master of second, third, fourth, fifth, and many other levels according to the development of the monad in the internal planes. That's why we always said each one of us has a master inside. So when I said, for instance, that my inner monad is a master is true. But also your inner monads are masters in different degrees. All depends on your work here with the rune ear and the rune man and when the rune laugh in order to develop more mastery within you. The monads always rely on all and other monads that are more developed. And that development always comes from the stone, from the rune laugh, from Christ. That's why when we said that our monad is a master, we are stating something that is already stated by the Master Samael on the Or. Now, the degree is something very personal. To unveil the degree of the monad is something that is useful only, like in the case of the Master Samael on the Or, that he's teaching, giving the knowledge. So everybody has to know that he is a monad whose mastery is a very high level, hierarchy, and that he's capable to teach the lower monads. And this is something that we have to understand. But among the Gnostics or among the brotherhood, the white brotherhood, there are many masters of different hierarchies. But remember that the Master Samael wrote in the Ignis Rose, the Christ substance extend itself in all the infinite space, and while we practice sexual magic, it is absorbed by each one of our seven bodies until Christ is formed within ourselves. These seven portals are something very personal, very intimate, very individual, and very profound. The path of the initiation is something very internal and delicate. In order to possess the reed, the disciple must liberate himself from all types of schools, religions, sects, political parties, concepts of motherland, flags, dogmas, intellectualism, selfishness, hatred, anger, opinions, classroom, arguments, authoritarianism, etc. There is a need to search for a guru in order for him to guide us along this internal and delicate way. The guru must be searched for within, in the profundity of the consciousness. Each disciple must search for the master inside, inside, inside. The master is found in the profundity of our consciousness. Because he's the monad. If you want to search for the master, abandon all bookish erudition and pseudo-spiritual schools. The master appears when the disciple is prepared. The gravest danger for the occultist is to have a bookish culture. The students of occultism who have read excessively are commonly filled with terrible pride, as we explained in the former lecture, that called mythomania, boast of that because you have knowledge, you are somebody else better than anybody. Remember that the master is always inside. It is the monad. The student who is vain due to the intellect feels as though he is the lord of the world, wisdom. He not only lamentably wastes his time going from school to school, but moreover, he closes the door of initiation to himself and falls into black magic, thinking that he's going to receive initiation just because it belongs to this school or to this religion, and the initiation is in relation with love, the rune love. Have you handled the grail? How do you handle the stone? How do you handle the rune ear? The upside-down cross. Every time that you go into the sexual act, remember, Peter go with you. Your brain, your pineal gland, go with you. And if you fornicate, and instead of rising the stone to your head and receiving the name of your God in the forehead, you become the fool. Fal Parsi. We must become like children in order to penetrate into the wisdom of the fire, which is deep within ourselves, in the living profundity of our internal consciousness. There is a need to be humble in order to acquire wisdom. Once we have acquired wisdom, we must be even more humble. Humbleness is something that you acquire when you comprehend your pride in all the levels, when you comprehend self-esteem. It is not that you have to fake humbleness. It's something that you have to develop when you comprehend your pride, when you stop boasting of this or that. You know, this is something that that we have to comprehend, because there is the attitude of many Gnostics, many esoteric students in other schools as well. They like to boast about themselves, and they like to be followed. Master Samael always stated, don't follow anybody. If you want to really enter into the path of initiation, follow your own being. Because your being has the degrees, the initiations that allow you to comprehend what you are comprehending. You want more comprehension, then go down into the ninth sphere. Work with the rune Laf. Work with your Peter. Transmute your sexual energy. So then your monad will receive more degrees, more comprehension, more understanding. And you, the soul, will be guided. But the problem is here that everyone wants to be guided outside. And it is good to find somebody that will indicate you what to do. But the last thing that you have to remember is this. You have to love your God with all your head, with all your heart, with all your strength, and the neighbor as thyself. But if you are always, in this day and age, people are looking for a guru outside, and they forget that their inner guru is inside. When you find your inner guru, your inner God within, then you can talk with other initiates in the internal planes. And every advice that you receive, and if it is positive, if you are doubting about it, go and meditate and concentrate in your God. My God, my Lord, this master told me this. Can you explain to me what this means? Because you are the reality within me. And here, this terrestrial man cannot understand it. I am this terrestrial man. Can you explain to me? And then you meditate. And then your guy will disclose that for you. What this master told you is this. What the master Samael said in these books is this. For you, for your level, for your degree. And this is how you had to comprehend this. That the guru, the master, is within, inside, is what the master said. But do not think that when we say that, I meant that all of you have a master of fifth degree inside of you. That you are Mahatmas, great souls. No. Because that has to be gained in the stone. Peter had to descend into the ninth sphere in order to receive the wisdom, the intuition. And how you descend is how you developed. That's why sometimes people misunderstand when we said, my guru, my inner monad, is a master. Because it is. It will be a big lie if I said that my inner monad is not a master, because it is a master. Of what degree? Well, that is personal. That is concerned only to myself. As you know, I always respect you and I see you, and I know that within each one of you, there is a monad. It's a master. Of what degree? Well, you have to discover that by yourselves. And if it is a lower degree, well, work with the stone, with love. I mean, do not laugh, but with life, which is a rune laugh. And remember that that rune is between the man and the ear, the man and the woman. And that the man is inside, is your monad. That's why when we said within every woman there is a man. For instance, we said in English, woman. And I ask, what is that wo in the woman? Because there is a man there. Well, and then she answered me, is a man with a womb capable of creating better than you? And I said, yes, it's right. Even though I can create here internally with the help of my woman, with my wife. But the woman needs a man in order to create too. She needs the seed. And when she receives the seed, in her womb, he creates a child. And all of us were created in a womb of that man, which is called female. Woman, woman. Behold the beauty of that name. That's why only the womb man, the man with the womb, is capable of standing in front of the man without womb, which is the male. Because the woman says, I need a seed, you give me the seed, and I will create for you a son. But if you approach me and you don't fornicate, then I will create within you the son of man, which is better. That's why the master Samael on Veor, let me show you here a graphic that I put there. When we placed Eros, the son of Venus, in Psyche, that is precisely what the master Samael stated in the book, The Perfect Matrimony. The son of man is born in the ninth sphere, in the Aztec calendar. There was the man is born, in the rune Laf. The son of man is born of water and fire. Water is the woman, fire is the man. When the alchemist has completed his work in the mastery of fire, he, you see, his soul, not his mind, not his ego, his soul, receive Eros, the Venustic initiation. That's why it's called the Venustic initiation. Why? Because the son of Venus, Aphrodite, is Eros. Or as we will say it in Christian terms, the son of Mary, the goddess Venus, the goddess of love, is Eros, Jesus. Jesus Christ. That is Eros, the god of love, that is born when the alchemist reaches the mastery of the fire, that is reached at the fifth initiation of Major Mysteries. When the initiate descends with Peter, with the rune ear, in order to take the life of the rune Laf with his wife, the woman also. When we said the initiate could be the woman or the man, the betrothal of the soul, the psyche, to the lamb, the son of Venus, Eros, is the greatest festival of the soul. That great lord of the light, Eros, enters her, the psyche. He becomes human and she becomes divine. From this divine and human mixture, that which is so much certainly the adorable certainty, the adorable one called the Son of Man is born. The greatest triumph of supreme adoration is the birth of the Son of Man in the manger of the world. When we said manger, comes into my mind the man. the rune man. Remember that that rune indicates the triad. Adman Budimanas. So that Eros, the son of Venus, is Jesus, the son of Mary. That is born when somebody reaches that level. The one that receives Eros is the manger in English. That manger, of course, is a monad, because it's the soul that wants to receive it. The soul that is Tifereth, the one that receives Eros. In this case, the soul is represented by Psyche, because the soul is always represented by a feminine aspect inside of us, that is marrying the Lord, which is Eros. That union is precisely the great goal for every initiate. To receive the Lord, Eros, Jesus, Osiris, Quetzalcoatl, or whatever name you want to give to that force, because according to the Greek Trinity, the Trinity is Chaos, Eros, and Gia. Gia is the earth. Chaos is Uranus, the sky. And between them is Eros, which is the sun. So to incarnate Eros, according to Greek mythology, is to incarnate Jesus Christ within us. It's the same thing. To develop the Lord within. To develop the manas. When I'm saying this, it comes into my mind the Venerable Master Samael on Veor. If you have one of his books, you will know that he clearly stated that he incarnated Eros in 1955. The inner Christ, the beautiful Cupid that we call the baby Jesus in Christianity. He incarnated him in his manger, in his own soul, and started working with it. We understood that because Christ, Eros, is not a person. It's an energy, it's a force. Like the electricity is an energy. But in order to incarnate this force, you need to be prepared. You need to build the church on the rock. Peter has to work first in order for John to come into yourself. Ioannes, the word. I personally like to investigate things internally. When I say this, I'm saying meditation. I read something that the master wrote and I close my eyes and I said, what is what the master is saying here? And of course, like that, I have the habit of doing it since many years ago. Investigating the process of the master Samael on the earth, because he is the avatar. And the Lord incarnated in him, Vishnu, as a baby, in order to give the doctrine that we are teaching here. And I was always observing in detail all the steps that physically he was doing in relation with his internal development. Why? Because he stated, everything that happens in the internal planes have to correlate with the physical plane. Otherwise, it's not true. If what we say and what we investigate and what we experience does not correlate with the physical plane, it is not true. But what we experience in the physical plane, it doesn't correlate with the internal planes, is not true. So you see, the two worlds, the internal worlds and the physical world, have to correlate. So I was observing his life in the last years that he was in Mexico to see where is the Lord, the baby that was born in 1955 and that grew up and now is an adult inside of him. In which level is he developed, is right now? And I remember that year after year, I was studying him and what he was saying and also meditating. So in the time when I was in the north of Mexico teaching Gnosis, the master invited us to Mexico for a special lecture that he was going to give in honor of the president of Mexico at that time. He was going to discuss a book that the president wrote that was named Quetzalcoatl. But of course, Quetzalcoatl, I know, is Christ among the Mexicans of ancient times. And I said, with the president of Mexico, he was honored there. And I said, okay, let us meditate and investigate what is the president of Mexico going to, or had to do with the Master Samael. He was amazing. He's dead now. But he was amazing. And he knew about the doctrine of the Gnostics. So then I went there in order to hear the lecture of the master. And I saw him. And everything that he said in his lecture in relation with this book written by the president of Mexico. And I said, okay, if I find similitude here, that means that the president is the mind. Is the head. Obviously, the intellect governs this world. The president of Mexico in Christianity, in relation with the drama, who is he? And I said to myself, oh, of course, he is Pilate. Pontius Pilate. Yeah, I'm not saying that he was literally that, but he was symbolizing that. For me, he is Pontius Pilate. And I was there and I was seeing the master really showing his own mastery. Ecce homo, behold the man there. Tremendous, beautiful lecture with a lot of wisdom. And everybody was applauding. Many ambassadors of many countries were there listening and they were surprised to hear all of this knowledge from the mouth of the Master Samael on the Or for the first time. Then I said, well, it is very critical this moment because if this president of Mexico represents Pontius Pilate, that means that the master is going to be crucified. And then I returned to the north of Mexico, very preoccupied about that. Months later, I received a call that the master was sick. And he was passing the process. Because he died in 1976. In that event that happened in Mexico, was in that year, in the month of September. But he was looking really very weak. So it was not a surprise for me when somebody called me from Mexico and said, the master is pretty sick. Please, pray for him. So I then started doing chains for him because I knew that he was in the process of being crucified and to die. Eventually, he has to die. So the 24th of December of 1976, his daughter called me very preoccupied. Please do chains for him. He is very critical, very sick. And I said, oh, what is happening? Well, was in the hospital, but now he is not as out of the hospital. He's in our home, but really he needs a lot of help. And then I remember a prayer that I always perform and that I like, to the Solar Logos. And then that day, the 24th of December, we perform a special work for him. And at the end, we were doing this chain. And in the chain, I was performing this prayer that some of you might know, and that is written in the book of medicine. I said, together with all the brothers making a chain after their special work that we did in order to attract the solar force, the Christ, and they knew that he was passing the process in the body of the Master. All thou, solar logos, igneous emanation, substance and consciousness of Christ, powerful life, whereby everything advances, come unto him and penetrate him, enlightening him, bathe him, go through him, and awake within himself, within his being, all of those ineffable substances that are as much as a part of thee as well as a part of him. Universal and cosmic force, mysterious energy, I conjure thee, come unto him, remedy his affliction, cure him from this illness, and put apart from him this suffering, so he can have harmony, peace, and health. I ask thee in thy sacred name, which the mysteries and the Gnostic Church have taught me, so that thou can make vibrate within him all of the mysteries of this plane and superior planes, and that all of those forces together may achieve the miracle of his healing. So be it. Of course, as you see, I changed me for him. I did it one time, the second time, the third time, concentrated in the solar light, in the cosmic Christ, in order to send the energy to him. But then, my third eye, my clairvoyant eye, started to spin, and a great picture came into my head when I was doing that chain with these brothers. And what did I see? I saw the Rune Man, the Lord, the Christ, crucified on the cross, as you see there in the graphics that we put in the website. When I saw that, I saw the Lord, the Christ, with my third eye, pronouncing the last word and dying on the cross. That's why I associate the Rune Man with that prayer. It was so disturbing because I am asking for life, not for death. And when I saw this, I immediately closed, pronounced the mantra Aum three times and said, this is it. What time is it? And they said, 8:20 p.m., the 24th of December. Later on, that day, I received a call after the midnight, and her daughter told me, please come to the funeral. So this is how internally you know, it's very emotional for me to say this. I kept this for myself through many years. But there are many speculations now about the transition of the Master. And I never liked to talk about, I never liked it, but I said I had to talk about this. But it's very strong for me. Because I saw the Lord, the Christ, dying there. At the same time that he was dying, when I went to Mexico to his funeral, I asked what time he died, and he told me, 8:20. That was too much for me. And after that, I continue with my habit of meditating, and everything that I read or that I study. And I was witness of his resurrection. I witnessed his ascension. And that's why I talk with certainty, because I saw this. But I understand that the Logos, the Christ, is something that incarnates, and in order to become human, and in order to self-realize any initiate, as he was incarnated in him and self-realized him, that Logos, he promised also to return, as he said in his books. But I always understood and comprehended that the one that was talking through him was the Lord. And I was so sure, not because I read it or because somebody told me, because I saw it many times. Many times I found him in internal planes. In a previous lecture, I said that a master said, a divine being says, I manifest myself through these hands. But then I forgot to tell you that the hands are the very end of the arms, and that the arms are part of Chesed and Geburah, the monad, and the hands are related with Tifereth. So the hands, Tifereth, that are united to the arms, represents the monad itself. So when this being was telling me, I manifest myself through these hands, he's telling me to that soul. So it is good to develop the soul internally, in order for the Lord to manifest. Remember, when you see your hands or the hands of anybody internally, it represents the soul. And this is precisely what we have to understand, that the spirit always manifests through the soul. But remember that the hands don't move, don't indicate anything if the brain doesn't command it. And this is something, a deep symbol that you have to understand, because every monad has his own hands that you have to know how to manifest or how to handle. So this is precisely related with this prayer. That's why when we talk about the rune men, we have to perform this, pronounce this prayer that I recited today. Of course, in this case, you have to say me. All thou solar logos, ignos emanation, substances, and consciousness of Christ, come unto me and penetrate me, enlighten me, pass through me, and all of that which is in that marvelous prayer that is written in the prayer book as well. We have now the prayer book there, the new book of prayings, and in the occult medicine. I know for sure that this rune man is associated with that prayer, because I experienced, I saw it. Because the rune man is precisely that. The Lord crucified on the cross. It's a way of praying. Now the rune laugh, which is the hands forming an angle of 45 degrees, is indicating in that way. You have to lift your hands up. So when you lift your hands, forming an angle of 45 degrees with your arms and your body, you just walk towards the east. It is good to perform this rune the 27th of each month, because 27 days takes the sun in order to make a rotation in itself. So that is a solar day for our planet Earth. In the internal planes, the temples perform special rituals, the 27th. So at dawn, 4 o'clock in the morning, you just perform the position of that rune and walk as the rune indicates towards the east, as I show you in the first rune there. You see the position of the rune Laf and the attitude of walking towards the east and praying. What type of praying? Whatever you want to ask to your inner Christ, to your inner master, to your inner monad, to your inner goddess, to the divine mother. Honor your father and your mother and pray. What do you need? Whatever you need is what you have to ask for. With simple words, as when you are talking to your mom or to your dad in the physical plane. The way you are talking with them when you were asking for a favor, the same way talk to your inner God. To pray is to talk with God. In a very slow motion, walk towards the east. Could be inside your home or outside, it doesn't matter. But the prayer has to go down inside to you, inside you. Now when you reach the east and finish your prayer, then perform the rune man and pray to the Lord as well. Reach your arms aloft. Lift. And say that. O thou solar logos ignis emanation. Actually, this rune man can be performed any day. The rune Laf is only the 27th. How the master Samael Onveor indicates in his book of runes. But this prayer is called the universal prayer to the Gnostic Church, which is a church in which the Lord, the Christ, internally works in. It's a Gnostic church. But you can find it in internal planes. Now, there is another prayer that we placed there for you in relation with the rune ear. Remember that this rune ear relates to the dissension of Peter into the stone, into the woman, into the earth, into Mary, in order to lift the energy up and to fortify his brain. But this rune is represented by the man, as you see there in the graphic, with the hands at the level of the sex. This is how you perform also the rune ear. And then you said to the Holy Spirit, which is in the pineal gland, that atom of the Holy Spirit control the waters of sexuality. In this prayer you said, terrifying king of the sea, thou who hast the keys of the floods gates of heaven, and who dost confine the subterranean waters within the caverns of the earth, king of the deluge and the showers of springtime, thou who dost unseal the sources of rivers and fountains, thou who dost ordain moisture, which is like the blood of the earth, to become the sap of the plants. We adore thee, we invoke thee, come unto us. We are thy miserable and unstable creatures. Speak unto us from thy inconstant and great commotions of the sea, so that we shall tremble before thee. Speak unto us also from the murmur of limpid waters, so that we shall yearn for thy love. O immensity into which flow all the rivers of life, to be continually reborn within thee. O ocean of infinite perfections, height which deepness reflects thy image, deepness which thou excel from the height, lead us unto true life by intelligence and love. Lead us to immortality by sacrifice, so that one day we may be found worthy to offer thee water, blood, and tears for the remissions of our sins. Amen. If you observe unto true life by intelligence and love, that means bina, intelligence. Love is gedula, or chesed, in other words. Because the Holy Spirit is the Lord of the waters. Is the Lord that from the pineal gland can control your waters of sexuality. So when you perform that rune in that position, before the sexual act, or if you can memorize the whole prayer, you can recite it during the sexual act. Because remember that the Lord emerges from the waters, and the Lord of the waters is the Holy Spirit, the white dove, that from above said, "This is my beloved Son," above in the pineal gland. When he see the chaste sun that is rising from the waters of the Jordan, he says, "This is my beloved Son. I am pleased with him. He's chaste. He's rising from the waters, from the rune laugh, thanks to the rune ear." You see, that's the mystery. And of course, Chesed is the spirit, the Ruach Elohim, the Spirit of God that was hovering upon the face of the waters. So you see the beauty of these runes, how each one relates to each other. It is not possible to talk about the rune laugh without talking about the rune ear and man, because they relate. They are entangled. If the woman was to work, the man has to work too. Ear and man, and laugh in between. Life. Do you have questions?
What's the name of that prayer?
The prayer of the Runeer. Yeah, that prayer relates to the exorcism of the water. Remember that the water of sexuality are related to your sexual glands. There where you find that water that we need to be baptized with. Mystery of baptism. Yeah?
Is it safe to assume then that the crucifixion of other saints is also indicative of the rune ear? Wasn't Andrew also crucified?
Well, no. The question is about the crucifixion of all the saints in relation with the rune ear. Now, the only one that relates to the rune ear and the crucifixion is Peter, because he's the upside-down cross. If man, which is represented by the Son of Man, Jesus Christ, was crucified on the cross in the way that we know, Peter represents the opposite. It means that in order to reach that level, first you have to descend to perform the cross upside down with all the mysteries of alchemy, the pineal gland, etc. Now, the crucifixion of Andrew, the brother of Peter, is different, because Andrew was crucified in the cross of in X, right? Which also relates, as we talked in the previous lectures, with the rune Gibor, right? And it is very important also to understand and comprehend that the sexual potency of the rune Laf, which is life, which is the stone, the grail, come from the kidneys. And the kidneys are related to Andrew and the Cruise and X, the forest of the kidneys, that give strength, sexual strength, to the man, to the woman. But also the hormones of the pineal gland relates to the strength of the sexual force. When a man has a very strong pineal gland, it's because his sexual force is very strong, and vice versa. But this is why when you read the Gospels, you find that Peter was the brother of Andrew, because the two of them relate to the sexual potency. But of course, the esotericism or the mystery of Andrew in relation with the cross is related with other aspects of the doctrine, which is the annihilation of the ego, the sufferings that the initiate has to pass through in order to crystallize within his soul, what he has to crystallize. And in order to destroy all the enemies of the Lord, which are our defects, vices, and errors, he has to utilize the cross, the potency of the kidneys in the sexual act. That's the mystery of Andrew. But Peter is different. Even though Peter always assists us in the different development that we need to acquire in the esoteric path. But remember that Peter is called the first apostle. Why? Because first we have to build the church. What is to build the church? Is to perform the rune ear in order to work with the rune Laf, life, and to build the astral body, the mental body, and the causal solar bodies. Although that is called solar bodies because they are created with a sexual force, with a transmitted sexual force. And the one that is doing that work is Peter. That's why he said, "Behold, I lay in Zion the stone that the builders disallowed." Who are the builders? Well, if you talk in the esoteric terms, there are the Masons. We will say that in this day and age, there are many Masons in the Masonry Lodge, but they don't transmute. They don't practice any sexual magic. So they are disallowing the stone, the rock, because they do not know about it. And even also other religions. In this case, the Catholic Church. The monks there, they don't marry. And if they marry, they don't transmute. So they also are rejecting the stone, which is Laf, the grail. The Holy Grail is a woman for a monk. And the stone for a nun is the man, in order to work with the grail. But if we are not doing that, of course, we are not working with Peter. In the Pieces of Ea, Peter says, "What this woman has to do with us, man? It's always interrupting us," he says in the Pieces of Ea. Because Peter without the woman cannot do anything. That's what's the meaning of that. We need the woman in order to work with Peter. And Peter knows it. That's why he says, "Crucify me upside down." So these initiates will understand that I am in the pineal gland and I have to descend to the ninth sphere, which is the woman, which is the Holy Grail, which is the Aztec calendar. Different symbols. Do you have any other question?
Yeah, I guess you should mention that the rune error was used negatively in the peace sign, of the 60s and peace.
Oh, the question is about the hippie sign of the rune ear, that they use it. Well, we will say that Hitler used also the swastika in the wrong way. And there are many groups in this era that utilize different signs of runic signs. Sometimes they do it because, as they say, it's cool. But they don't know the meaning of it. As I was always wondering why the hippie movement adopted that rune ear for their sign. I don't know. Maybe it's because they were sexually liberated, because they were performing sex without any scruples, right? Obviously, they were performing the rune ear as we perform it, but not like Peter. They were not transmuting. They were not lifting their head up. And this is still this day and age. Sexual freedom, they call it. And when anybody can do any type of sexual degeneration, and they applaud them when they go into these TV shows, because they declare themselves this and that type of degenerated being. This is how this society is, really utilizing the rune ear in the wrong way. But with the Gnostics, we perform the rune ear, but Peter cross of ear. That's the rune ear, YR, ear of Peter. That is stone. We have to transmute the sexual energy. Otherwise, we will fall like the fool. Fal Parsi. Remember that. When the phallus becomes full, then we go into Klipoth. And that's precisely the direction. Peter says, go down, but go up. But people go down and continue going down into the inner layers of the earth, into Klipoth. Question here?
When Master Samael refers to the superlative consciousness of the being, is this superlative consciousness related with the particular sphere of the middle triangle, or is it related with all of them?
When the Master Samael talks about the superlative consciousness of the being, of course, the being is the innermost. And the superlative consciousness is Geburah. That Geburah has to be developed through different steps, through the second mountain. When the initiate enters into the second mountain, then he is liberating the different levels of Geburah, the spiritual soul, the superlative consciousness of the being. Because the human soul becomes the human soul, which is lower, is the one that is here expressing itself through the physical world. But the superlative consciousness of the being is Geburah, within which the principles of the Lord, the Christ, Chokhmah, are developed. And of course, what is the goal? To acquire the trident, the objective reasoning of the being, the trident, represented by the rune man. There are 7 degrees of objective reasoning. No subjective reasoning. The subjective reasoning is related with the ego. But the objective reasoning of the being is the superlative consciousness of the being. When you develop certain comprehension and reasoning in relation with the spirit and your Geburah, and that development is related with the second mountain. When you finish the second mountain, then when the initial resurrects, receives 1 trident, 2 tridents, or 3 tridents, different tridents. 6, I said 7, but 6. 6 are the degrees. The last degree is called anklad. It's the highest degrees that any initiate can acquire. Of reasoning, comprehension. Together, that goes with the 5 senses and the 7 chakras. The way in which the initiate comprehends the doctrine. That is in relation with what we call the auric embryo. The auric embryo is the superlative consciousness of the being, which acts, of course, in the physical body, astral body, mental body, causal body, in all the bodies. And that auric embryo gives you comprehension in relation with the degree of development that you acquire in resurrection. Some initiates, for instance, that reach the second degree of objective reasoning, decide to acquire another degree, and for that, they had to say, Peter, I had to descend with you to the ninth sphere, help me. Because the reasoning that I have, the degree of reasoning that I have right now, is not enough for me. I want more intelligence. So then they descend with Peter. But most of them, when they descend with Peter, they fornicate and they become the fool, a fallen bodhisattva. Otherwise, in the universe, different initiates descend. We have to understand what is a descension and what is a falling. To fall is to fornicate. To descend is to practice sexual magic and not to reach the orgasm. So many initiates, when they acquire the trident of Neptune, which represents the mind, the trident of Raphael, the lord of the mind, and they talk with the other resurrected masters. For instance, when you talk with the master Jesus of Nazareth, he has unclad the sixth degree of objective reasoning. His doctrine is so high that you need to work very hard in order to understand his doctrine. It's written in the Pistis of Ea. But below him, there is other masters that have other degrees. Poculad, Ternolad, Dennolad. You can find those names in the Pistis of Ea. Different degrees. So for instance, a master with Ternonald, degree of objective reasoning, if he wants to acquire the level of unclad, well, he has to practice the rune ear, mean to descend into life, because for them, the sexual act is prohibited. But if they want more reasoning, more intelligence, more wisdom, they have to descend. And that's the problem. Because after millions or thousands of years without performing the sexual act, some of them, they cannot control the sexual organ and they fall. So through the rune ear, they fall. That's why the rune ear is 16, number 16. So to perform that rune is very delicate. You have to pray. That's what the praying that we show here to the Holy Spirit, to the Lord of the sea, which is inside of you, it's necessary in order for you to receive the help. Because if you forget Poseidon, Neptune, the lord of the sea, the lord of your sexual force, and you think that you can do the things like Odysseus by yourself, and then you are punished. That's why it is written that many angels fell with the daughters of men in the book of Genesis, trying to acquire more objective reasoning, another trident, knowing that Neptune is the one that could give you another trident. Neptune could appear and say to you, Holy Spirit, do you want another trident? You want more intelligence? I can give you that. But for that, you have to descend with Peter. But woe of you if you fornicate, because then you will become Falparsi, the fool. Remember that in order to acquire wisdom, you need the grail. And the only one that can penetrate the grail, which is the sexual feminine organ, is the phallus per se. And some of them perform their sexual act without spilling the mercury of the wise, and work very hard in order to acquire another level of objective reasoning. That's why among the masters, among the initiates, resurrected ones, you have many levels of wisdom. Master Samael on the Or, in his last incarnation, he said, I hope my Lord will give me now unclad. That means that he didn't have unclad. What degree he had, I don't know. I never asked him. But he was with the longing of Aquinas and Clark, which is the higher level of objective reasoning. And this is precisely among the resurrected masters. That objective reasoning that you acquire after resurrection, listen carefully, is never lost. You never lose it. When I said you, I'm talking about your monad. Now I had to emphasize this because sometimes I said you and people understand the ego, the man, terrestrial man here. No, it's the being, the one that receives that objective reasoning. It's Keter, and Chesed, the monad, that receives that reasoning. So one has acquired, you never lose it. I mean, the monad never loses it. But you, as a soul, you can lose it, of course. You fall like a fool. You say, where is my vehicle? I don't know. Yeah? It's already in hell. So you lost what I gave you, right? Now you want to acquire more? Well, fight. And maybe you will acquire more. But the thing is this. That's why the Master states, when a fallen bodhisattva enters a group, immediately is recognized because the objective reasoning, the auric embryo that his mona has the level. He never loses it. To recuperate that is another thing. But has the ability to comprehend, to understand things. This is something that you had to put in your head. Question. Another question here?
Yeah. Why is it stated then that when a master descends, he is then submerged to samsara again? Or should it be understood that it is the master, the monad, is the one that doesn't fall?
When the soul of the master is the one that submerged into samsara.
When a master descends, he is then submerged to samsara again?
The monad, yes. But it's a soul that is more related to the samsara, right? So once the soul is in the samsara, which is Malkut, in order to acquire more reasoning, of course, that master has to wait until the bodhisattva rises again. But that master is always a master, you see? Talking here about a fallen bodhisattva that descends or that falls as well. The master is always the master. The mastery is never lost. Once you acquire, you never lose it. When I said once you, I remember again. I emphasize again. You is the monad, not you, the ego. And during meditation, your monad can tell you many things, and then you say, okay, I understand that, and you receive it, because you have the capacity of understanding, because your monad reached that level in past ages. Now, of course, if you rise again to the same level, that level of reasoning will be higher. That's obvious. If you rise again. There are many bodhisattvas there in hell that they are really not wanting to rise again because it's very difficult. The karma that you have to pay is always the double, triple, very hard. Yes?
You mentioned the ascension.
The ascension of the Lord inside is in relation with the second mountain as well, in relation with the third mountain. In order to acquire, for instance, the ascension of the Master Samael, the third mountain, you have to comprehend many Kabbalistic and alchemistic things in order to see how that is associated with the mission that he is performing in this day and age with this humanity. He is doing it, and this knowledge is stronger and stronger because he is ascending. He is already in the third mountain. He finished the second mountain in 1977. So he is a very high master now, going back into the absolute, and hopefully for him to maybe he acquired already the level of unclad. That will be good for all of us. And that's the ascension, because the second mountain is a resurrection. Now, with Peter, you enter into the first mountain, which is the initiation. First mountain of initiation relates with the building of the church inside of you, the temple, your own Merkabah. Second mountain, the annihilation of all that which we are, egotistically speaking, in order to acquire objective reasoning. Third mountain is in relation with the work, the mission that the Lord, the Christ, has to do through you with humanity. Do you have another question? Thank you very much.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy. Yeah, Lord,